Welcome back to Code Station 33. Last time we were here, we were looking at the decomposition of problems. Today we're going to put that into some practical application. We're looking at the missing side of the hypotenuse of a triangle. And we want to start taking our pseudocode that we were looking at last time. So let's take a look at that. And we want to look into using that pseudocode in order to get our computer to calculate our function for us. So let's go ahead and look at doing that. We're going to go into Tinkercad. I'm going to put this over here so we have it on our screen, like that. So we're going to start with a blank Arduino project again, and we'll take a look at back and forth between our pseudocode plan and this Arduino project and start designing parts of this project. Now we're going to design this over two lessons. The first lesson, we're going to focus on creating functions that accept information. And then later on, we're going to modify those functions so that they can not only accept information, which we call parameters, but also return that information to be used later in the code. So we're going to use the pseudocode a couple times. So if we go back and take a look at this, we said we wanted to be able to create a function that's going to collect information about the sides of a triangle, read in one number at a time, make sure it's a triangle, and then store that number in some way, and then return the number. We'll talk about how to do that next time. We're going to focus on this time is how to calculate the missing side of the hypotenuse. And we're not going to return it, we're just going to print it to the screen. So let's talk about how do we calculate the missing side. And in order to do that, we're going to need to get the data about our missing side. We have to know what are the two other sides. So we're going to need to input that data into our function. So let's go ahead and create our function. So we're going to put it down here underneath void loop, and we're going to make it void for now. That means it's not going to return anything to start. We're going to call it find side, and I'm using camel case again, but in this case, instead of just putting the empty parentheses, which means I'm not sending information, I'm going to add in what we call parameters. And when we define parameters, we have to first define the type. So we're going to use an int. Let me make this bigger so you can see exactly what I'm typing. I'm going to send it an integer because I know the number has to be an integer for the side of my triangle. In this case, I don't want to send it a decimal. I don't want to deal with that. For right now, we're just going to send it an int. And I'm going to call this x and then int y. Now, the variables I use are entirely up to me. I like x and y for sides of a triangle. It just seems to make sense. If you want to do b and c, that's fine. Maybe we'll do that. B and c, just because it kind of fits a and b, or the two sides, because it kind of fits the math that we're used to doing in school. If you want to use a longer name, you can. But remember, these two variables, a and b, the scope of those two variables is only going to be inside of the function find side. We cannot access them anywhere else. So the names that we pick are only going to be for this. We could send something to B and send something to A, and we're going to do that inside the loop. So I could create two other variables, maybe int side 1, and I'm going to say that is equal to 3, and int side 2, and that is equal to 4. And I'm going to call find side, and I'm going to send it side 1 and side 2. So far we really haven't done anything with that information. All I'm doing is setting up the structure. The method is called, the function, excuse me, is called, and we're sending it the arguments, side one and side two. Those values, the numbers that are stored in side one and side two, namely three and four, get mapped to the variable b and the variable a. Now a and b, we can change and manipulate, do whatever we want with a and b, and they're not gonna have anything to do with side one and side two. They're gonna be independent because they're what we call primitives. So they're really essentially making a copy of the information and sending the information by value over to our function. Now there are more complicated structures that don't necessarily make a copy and that involves objects, and we're gonna not talk about that in this course. But for our purposes, it's really making it a copy, and the only thing we're gonna look at is inside the scope of here, any changes we make to B or any changes we make to A are gonna have no effect whatsoever on side one or side two. Now we wanna calculate our side one and side two values, the A and B values, and use those A and B values to figure out the hypotenuse. But the hypotenuse we're gonna do as a float, just because it could be long, it could be a big number when we start squaring things. H-Y-P, oh, I missed an O. O-T-E-N-U-S-E, H-Y-P-O-T-E-N-U-S-E, better. And that is gonna equal to the square root, and we used our math function, and it is going to be A times A plus B times B. And PEMDAS will happen here for us automatically, and the computer will do A times A, which is A squared, and do B times B, which is B squared, and then add the results together. I could just as easily use another math function and use the power function, or use the squared function if I wanted to, but I think in this case it just makes simple sense to just use the A times A and the B times B, and we're going to use the square root. And then finally, we're going to print it out. And I'm using a print here rather than a print line because I want the variable result to print on the same line as the text. Make sure everything is spelled right. So before we run this, let's review what we did. We have our setup program, which runs only one time, our setup function, and it's starting a serial monitor. We have our loop, which will run over and over and over again, and inside of our loop function, we are calling side one and side two. We're creating those two variables. They only exist inside the loop. We're gonna call our method, our function findSide, and send two arguments, side one and side two. Then findSide, that function, receives those arguments as parameters A and B. And then we're gonna calculate using some math functions to get the hypotenuse. And then finally print them out using some print line functions for us onto the screen. And when we run this, remember it's a float, so it's gonna print it as a decimal. And we start our simulation, and now we have the hypotenuse is printed to the screen. The hypotenuse is 5. So if I change the numbers here, it's gonna give me a different value. I can change the numbers. Let's do 6 and 8, and we should get 10 is the hypotenuse. If you know anything about some geometry, you know we can do this in 3, 4, 5 and figure out the values pretty quickly just to verify that the computer is working. But we could also do it with numbers that we don't know. I could do, let's do 23 and 17. Now we're gonna start getting some bigger numbers. And we could see, the hypotenuse is 28.6. This is why we need to make sure the hypotenuse is a float, because when you take the square root, you have the possibility of getting a decimal. So we had to make sure our hypotenuse was a float so we can get that decimal. even though A and B were integers. Now, we could decide to rewrite this, and instead of having integers here, we could send floats. And that would allow us to include decimals. But we'd have to make sure that these were also floats, because the types have to match. The type of argument being mapped to the parameters, the argument that's being sent to the parameters has to match. So when I hit start simulation and now again, it's going to work fine. It's going to give me the same result. But now I could send in 23.5 and 17.8. And it works, and we get 29.48. So now in this version, we can send decimals, because sometimes our triangles have decimals. And we want to make sure that we're still going to get a workable answer. So we have to send floats. If we're sending floats, we have to receive floats. Those types have to match. And that's how you create a function where you are receiving values. You define those values inside the parentheses. You have to define the type. And you have to make sure that the type matches from the arguments that is sending to the parameters that are receiving. Often we'll call this piece here the signature of the function. The arguments and the types, the data types that are within inside those parentheses are the signature, excuse me, I should say parameters and data types are the signature of the function findSide, and findSide is the name, and the return type is void still because we're not sending information back. Well, the next thing we're going to look at is how do we send and receive information back and forth from a function. That's all for today. I will see you next time.